Hey, this is Angelo John Lewis for the Diversity and Spirituality Network. And for those of you that are not familiar with us, we are a group of people actively exploring the integration of diversity and spirituality. If you'd like to know more about us, please go to our website, diversityandspirituality.com. Today, I'm privileged to interview Niambi Jaha-Echols. Niambi is the principal and lead consultant for Cross Cultural Agility LLC, where she trains, coaches, and consults individuals and corporations on issues supporting cultural intelligence and new pathways to inclusion. She's also the founder and president of the Butterfly Movement, where she utilizes the symbolism of the caterpillar butterfly metamorphosis to foster emotional and spiritual transformation in women and girls, particularly African-American girls. She's also the author of Project Butterfly, Inspiring the Soul of Our Girls, and the forthcoming book, What Color is Your Soul? Niambi, welcome to the podcast.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you for this opportunity. I'm excited.
Now, my standard question I have to ask you, because as we are diversity and spirituality, give me a sort of a sense as, about you, about your sort of background spiritually.
Spiritually.
We can go diversity if you want. Of course, we can see you.
I'm in this brown earth suit this time.
But I should say those people on the video podcast can see you.
But I grew up south side of Chicago. I was able to, my parents put all seven of their children through Catholic grammar school or primary school and high school. So, of course, Catholicism had an influence with the nuns. But at the same time, juxtaposition to that, I was actually attending a missionary Baptist church with my mother. So I grew up with, that influence as well. As an adult, I've had kind of an eclectic spiritual background. I've been a member of the Worldwide Church of God with Herbert Armstrong. I did that for a minute. I have done been influenced by Eastern philosophies, Buddhism. I tried Taoism for a minute. I've explored different African cosmologies with Yoruba and studied with shamans. I have been adopted into the Lakota Sioux tribal family. So I have a very eclectic spiritual background as well as religious, and which has kind of morphed into this I kind of weave a lot of different philosophies, and the real basis of all of them is love.
Yes.
And truth. And so they're just different languages. So I'm multi lingual as far as religions, and I respect all philosophies that honor a divine presence, and whatever you call that, that's good. But as long as we get to the end result of love, it's all good for me.
Now, Niambi, many people, I don't know many people, but one of the things you're well known for is the butterfly movement.
Yes.
And this is a project, as I understand it, particularly focused on African-American girls, mm-hmm. and helping them with the project of what you call reframing, reconnecting, regenerating, and reactivating as they rebuild their personal and land ecology all over the planet. Oof.
That's a lot.
Yeah. What I'd like you to do, Niambi, is briefly define the project and how your personal story dovetails with some of the young girls and young women that you, you basically seek to serve.
Absolutely. This was started back in the early 2000s, and I was going through my own personal transformation at the time, and the butterfly analogy just, came to me and came through me as I was making my own personal transformation. And so when I came back to Chicago, I had just got out of a really tumultuous first marriage, which was kind of crazy. I loved him, he loved him. And So I went on this journey to really find myself and to explore my own self-love. And so the whole butterfly analogy came through, and I went through my own metamorphosis. And so when I got back to Chicago, I was doing my own work. I was actually living as a visual artist. And so I was also studying art therapy at the time, and was pursuing a path to become an art therapist, and started working with adults. And these teachers started, you know, saying, well, you should be working with girls. And so they weren't even on my radar, because I didn't have any children at the time, and my nieces were very young. And so at one point, just got an opportunity to work with girls from three different, very diverse places, and didn't have a curriculum. And so decided, when I started looking for something that spoke specifically to girls and their transformation, I couldn't find anything. And so I got mad and I wrote Project Butterfly. Mm. And it went out kind of underground as this, because it filled a gap, and it was so comprehensive, till it later turned into a camp and an after school program, and, you know, just a whole organization. And right now it's still morphing, as I have a national director, and she's in Oakland, California, Brandy Mack. And she is a farm her. So she, part of our mission now has transformed not just to personal development, but also reconnecting women and girls to the land, and helping us to heal that relationship of remembering a lot of that disconnect that happened to us through our ancestral space. You know, a lot of us, you know, see farming as work, and you know, the disconnect because of plantations, because of the enslavement of our ancestors. So we've got some of that cellular memory still in us. So helping us to heal those parts so that we can reconnect back to the earth and all of the vibrancy that Mother Earth holds for us. But if we're not connected to it, we miss out on many of those blessings, not just in our in what we eat, but how we heal. All of that is connected to our connection to the earth. So I'm really excited about that. I've kind of diverted a little bit to more helping the planet, and Brandy is holding down that sacred space that I hold in my heart for our girls. So I kind of dip in and out of that, but this new book is more for the planet and a much broader audience.
Yeah, we're gonna get to your book, but I want to stay on this for a little bit because I think it's kind of interesting. You know, sometimes I think, as an African American man, and one who I guess flows freely in the space of races and ethnicities and sexual orientations, the whole thing. Sometimes I think there's like a particular destiny, if you will, of these different groups. And as an African-American woman, I guess we don't really need to get too full-blown into this, but I wonder if you could talk about some of the challenges that African-American girls and women in particular deal with in terms of getting in touch with their own spiritual sense and who they are.
Absolutely. I think one of the biggest challenges is really understanding how, well, I think we're changing that now, because Black girl magic is real, and we are starting to come into owning all of the gifts that come through us, just the sacredness of us. And so much of, I think, Black girls and Black men, but particularly Black women, historically have been, our bodies, we haven't owned our bodies because they've been subject to others. We haven't been able to own just our hair, our features, just all of the things that make us who we are. So what Project Butterfly was addressing, or does address, is healing those things and helping us to really understand our worth, and how much our gifts don't have to mimic other cultures, that they are valid and good just on their own. Mm-hmm. And helping us to realize that, because so much of our girls, if we never see examples of our greatness and our magnificence, it's hard to really see that and to to really own that. So now the culture is changing. We see many more examples of women that are powerful and beautiful and natural and all of those things. And just the plethora of, you don't have to be natural, but you can, you know, there's so many different ways to express our cultural beauty. And so I'm excited and empower girls, and we're hoping to be the wind beneath their wings, because a lot of times they grow up in environments where you don't really get that, and you don't get told enough how incredible you are, that you are divinely inspired, you know, that you are, you know, so that's really the crux of it, is helping us to remember that we are, you know, part of the divine, that we're not mistakes, that we are here on purpose, and helping us to really understand and live that. So that's what makes me excited, when girls get excited, because nobody's ever told them that they're a spiritual being. Nobody's ever told them that they have a purpose and a plan that's uniquely theirs. So that's what we help to unfold.
I mean, we could talk about this for the whole time of our podcast, and we won't, but just one
little... We'll have to do another podcast.
Yeah, maybe. One little piece I want to get in there is, you know, when I think of like the four races, and there's more than four races, but when you talk about oppression, you basically talk about white males, white females, you know, black males, black females. Of those four, the group that is just recently starting to have some visibility and some sense of self-worth, and of course I'm generalizing, is black women. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one of the things you didn't talk about, but I know you know about, because I've read a little bit about your book, is that a lot of us, and I'm talking us African-Americans, but also women in particular, have to go through the church. Mm-hmm. And that's a good thing and a bad thing. Mm-hmm. I wonder if you could talk about that just briefly.
Well, I think going to the church, you know, that, you know, when we came here, this is again, just ancestral stuff. When we came here, we had to hide our spirituality, and it had to be cloaked. Through religion, through a more acceptable expression of religion. And so that has stuck, I think. And so it's easy for us to get I guess, not confused, but just get stuck in religion and not move to spirituality, not moving to that place where it is more personalized and not just ritual. And I think that's where we're moving. That's where we're evolving to. But religion has been used as a resource, but also has been weaponized in so many instances. And so in that oppression, that a lot of people get stuck and they never move beyond it, you know, to the point where they're free to know that God is love and God is not sitting somewhere punishing us and oppressive,
right?
You know, so it's almost like we have this abusive relationship with God and see them as kind of a abusive parent or spouse or just this abusive relationship. And so it's having a different relationship than frees you to have a different experience. And that's what I'm hoping that, you know, I can help model, but also help foster that in other women and people in general.
So one of the interesting things about your book, you talk about a blueprint for helping individuals and groups heal and transform racism. And it kind of dovetailed, Niambi, with something which it's a book which I just picked up called Ancestral Medicine. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times when I talk to political people all the time, and sometimes I think that it's like, I don't know if things can be cured on its own level. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So there's all this racism around us, all this kind of negative stuff around there. And as somebody that's been involved with this kind of work for on and off for many years, I almost think that a lot of the efforts of diversity efforts are just moving the chairs around in the room. And things stay the same. And I think a very important piece is the ancestor thing.
Absolutely.
Now, a lot of people have lots of different viewpoints on it, but I know from looking at your book, you have a particular point of view and some experience in terms of what I'm going to call ancestor medicine. I wonder if you could just address that.
Absolutely. And I'm so glad that you brought that up, because I do think it's a lot of shuffling of chairs, because the core element is missing, and that is our spirituality. Mm-hmm. We cannot heal on the same level that the pain is occurring. You have to rise to a different understanding, to a different level. And, you know, it's just us understanding too that we are spiritual beings. And so, and that we have access to a higher consciousness, that we have access to more than what is just on the surface. And so that ancestral healing, to me, it's very much, I mean, it's grounded in all of the indigenous cultures and philosophies, that we are on this continuum, that there is the philosophy of I am because you are therefore I am, that we are connected. There is no us versus them, that there is just a we. And so when you think of life in that way versus the European thought, is that I think therefore I am, and it's very linear and narrow in its perspective. There is no thought that, because there is no connection to what my actions are solely my actions, therefore I'm only responsible for me and what I do. Whereas in a more holistic way of thinking is that, you know, what you do affects me, that we are all interconnected. So I am responsible for not only me, but I'm also responsible to and for you, which is very different. And so it's not just on the physical in our current way of thinking, but also for our ancestors and for those that are coming behind us. You know, I speak of that, like in the book, I give the example of how in my family, for instance, and I'll get just personal here, but I grew up with two parents who were didn't have the model from their parents of how to do healthy conflict resolution. So my parents would model for us, when they would get angry, my father would explode verbally. I never saw him hit my mom, but he would just be very abusive verbally. And then she would battle back with him, and neither one of them would listen. And then it would be followed, because they had seven kids, it would be followed by this deafening silence. They would work around each other and they wouldn't talk. And so they would just give each other the silent treatment. And so I learned that pattern of conflict resolution. It was either blow up or it was either to disconnect. You know, if I didn't like some, I just disconnect, you know, write you off kind of thing. And, but so I became conscious of that. And I knew that when I got married again, I was not going to, I didn't want to bring that into my family. And so talking to my mom, I, you know, traced it back. Her parents were like that. And so it's like a generational thing. So as I heal myself, I'm also healing my son, and how I'm giving him a different paradigm to work through, and hopefully giving him a different experience, because he doesn't see my husband and I, we don't do that. We talk. We never give each other the silent treatment. We work through things. And so that's not going to be my son's experience. And so so healing that within me is healing also the generation before. I really do feel like it's a continuum. And so I'm healing those wounds of my father and those family ties, that disconnect, that emotional dysfunction. But I'm also healing it forward. Because now my son has a different experience and will heal his children through that. So we're all interconnected, genetically, energetically. And it's when we realize that, then we can be more mindful of how we interact with each other, that we are shifting the narrative for everybody we interact with, be it positively or negatively. Everything has an effect.
Now, I think in your book, you also talk about some experience you have with some Native American folks with regard to this whole ancestor thing. Could you share
that? Yeah, I mean, and as I was stating, I think I told you earlier, or maybe I didn't mention this, but I was blessed. I do a lot of transformational work. And I was blessed to, I've been blessed to do several workshops or facilitate some healing work at Pine Ridge on the reservation and with the Lakota Sioux. And so I have, in one particular incident, we had a collective of both brown, black women and white women. And we did this healing piece. It was about ancestral healing because you can't really sit in circle with people if they are triggering those memories of high crimes that have been committed cross-culturally. You know, it's like, I think that's the piece that we're missing, because a lot of times we sit in a circle and everybody wants to sit and be kumbaya and, right. And love, but not addressing the elephant in the room. And the elephant in the room is this energetic piece that is ancestral. You didn't right. do it, but you represent it. And so it's in the room. And so we were all sitting, it was a group of women, and we were all sitting there, and it was clear that we were, and it was evident that we were not going to get beyond the surface with each other, because there was a lack of trust in the room. There was a lot of pain. There was some women, there were some Native American women in the circle who were actually the victims of being kidnapped during and sent to boarding schools, and they were elders, and there were ones that had relatives that had that. So there was this palpable just tension in the room. And there were white women who were just there to, you know, be in circle with the Native American, with indigenous women. Right. And it was just,
they're trying to be cool, but they didn't understand why it wasn't cool.
Right. That, you know, why we can't get along. And what we can't get along, because there's a big elephant in the room. Yeah. So being intuitive, and I had, you know, I've been blessed that while I was there, I was able to kind of sleep in this room that was full. It was like this atrium kind of circular or solarium kind of room that had all of these pictures of Native American ancestors, and from Crazy Horse to, you know, just a plethora of all of their warrior ancestors. And so I slept in that room every night. And so one day I got up during, it was like in the middle of the training, and I realized that we needed to do some ancestral healing. And so part of that healing was the fact that we need to, the white women were representative of their ancestors. And so they needed to own that to a certain degree. And so we had some other processes in that. But part of it was being able to stand as representatives of our ancestors so that we could heal those wounds that we didn't create, not in this lifetime or that we are cognizant of, but that are still there, that you are representative of your family and you are representative of your cultural family, whether you like it or not.
Yeah, that's a hard piece for white folks to get in general. I ain't got no slaves. You know, I mean, this is the kind of conversation that you hear from folks. You know?
Exactly. And it's because of the way that they have been conditioned to believe that they are separate from everybody else in the whole world. Everybody, every other indigenous group in the world believes that we are connected, except for the white philosophy. And so I kind of deal with that at the very beginning of the book. I have a story called Akna and Her Children, the story of Akna and her children. And it's, I was given some very creative license, and it's kind of a along the African cosmology of creation story of how we got separated and disconnected as cultures. And it helps to kind of help us to understand that mindset and where it started and how we look at the world so differently that in the, sometimes in the European mindset, it's so angry and separate that it's separate from everybody else. It's a different way of conquering the world rather than being a part of the world and owning and loving the world. It's a competition versus collaboration spirit. And so I think that's where that divide is. And once white people become more cognizant of it and willing to heal it, then I think that's where they shift. And some of them are. Some of them are making huge efforts and strides and trying to break that up. But the real trick, though, and what makes this so interesting is that genetically we are all mutts, yes. You know? Yeah. So I've got white ancestry that I've got to heal, that are running through my veins, that are making me incongruent. Because, you know, it's a push-pull that if I'm not conscious of it and awareness, you know, honing in my awareness, then I can be just as ruthless. I can be just as all of those things. So it is a conscious, I consciously make sure that I am healing those wounded parts of me and finding where those threads are within me so that I can root it out. But it will take mindful, conscious, awareness and intention. I think that's the biggest word, is intention. You have to be and we all have things to heal. Nobody is exempt, because we've been all under the shadow of racism and under this philosophy. We were born into it, so it's hard for us to see many times, especially white people, because it's like a fish trying to see water. It just is, and they feel it differently than we do.
You know, one of the things that interests me is this kind of dynamic between white women and black women. And I don't know if you paid attention to any of the stuff that was happening online in the past year, 2018. There were people that were involved in personal growth stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to be very good with remembering the specifics. Maybe I'll post a link to it. But, you know, they're very famous white women. Would be doing workshops, mm-hmm. and did things that many of the African-American, particularly women, seemed as culturally insensitive, mm-hmm. cultural appropriation. Mm-hmm. And also, for that matter, to broaden it just a little bit, in the whole sort of, what would you call it, the state of people doing holistics and this, that, and the other thing, generally speaking, what it seems like often is that it's a bunch of white folks. And maybe they'll appropriate some black icons or something, right. Or Indian icons or people of color icons. It's a kind of a subtly toxic kind of thing. But I'm going a little but the thing I want to really talk about is the whole thing with like black women and white women. What do you think that's about?
Oh, well, of course I thought about that. And I think, from my perspective, I think it goes back to, again, the enslavement of our ancestors. And even though white women didn't directly commit crimes, they were complicit in it. And so that that complicit nature of, you may not have raped my great-great-grandmother, but you knew about it. Your ancestors knew about it and they did nothing. They took a blind eye, and it's almost like this, the white women have been conditioned to be the icons of beauty, for one, and also just helpless. They are there, you know, to be rescued, and so they have full reign of the world. That, you know, white men basically conquer the world to present it to white women. And so there is this subtle feeling that they have no restrictions on, and there is an ownership of everything, you know, ownership of touching my hair. You can, you know, when I'm shopping in a grocery store, you can go through and comment what's on it in my basket. Mm-hmm. You can call the police if you think I'm out of order, you know, which we've seen an array of that, of, you know, the golf cart Debbie, or, you know, that we've Gail, or, you know, we've kind of named these women who are calling police on just crimes that, I mean, things that they consider crimes that, you know, don't warrant a call to 911. But it speaks to, and what that triggers for us is that complicit nature of white ancestral women that has happened in the past. And so when we see it happening, it's hard for us to connect. I think if if anything that we have to work on is healing those wounds, because I think that there's some parts of white women that really do want to be allies and they just don't understand because they haven't really addressed it, those wounds, and how that their aunt, what is within them is that complicit nature to not really value other cultures. And there's a really good book by Dr. Robin DiAngelo that talks about white fragility. And she speaks on how just that racism is invisible to many times to white people. And I think that more than anything is the barrier to our authentic interconnectedness, is that white women don't understand how they have been complicit in history, that their ancestors have been complicit historically to the oppression of brown and black women. That's what has to heal.
Yeah, I'm gonna spotlight an even older book. I'm not familiar with your text, but I remember one I read as a young man. I'm considerably older than you. It's called Sex and Racism in America by the late Calvin Hurton. It's it just sort of runs it down and better than I've ever seen. So just called that attention.
Well, another good resource, absolutely.
So I saw this quote. Let me see if I can find it from your book. I was kind of like skimming through it today, and I found this particular passage, which I don't know if I could find. Here it is. And it goes, I'm going to quote you. If I were to summarize the main block of commercial advertising on both networks, and you're talking about like black media and white media, basically, it would be anger and frustration on the black collective consciousness station and fear and deep denial in the white collective consciousness station. Mm-hmm. Each group vibrates on a different frequency, like different radio stations. One is an AM radio station, and the other is emitting from an FM station. Two very different vibrations that will continually keep us at odds because the frequencies are so different. That is deep, baby girl. I wonder if you could just like speak to that a little bit.
Yeah, well, I think that's true. That, you know, we have to really understand that everything, one, we're energy, and everything is vibration, everything. And so the vibration of frustration is different than the vibration of denial and shame. And so because we speak two very different languages, because we are on two different frequencies. And so a lot of times that contributes to our cross-cultural frustration with one another, because it's like, we can't even talk. You're not
even here, right?
You can't hear me. You can't see me. You can't even understand what I'm saying. And so I think that is what leads to a lot of just the disconnect and us not really getting it as far as how to really bridge that cross-cultural gap. And to me, the only way that we can, again, you can't solve the problem at the same rate that it's happening, that you have to rise above that the only way that we can really solve that is to bring spirituality into the mix, not religion, but spirituality. And that in that spirituality is to raise our vibration, to a different frequency. And that's doing our own personal healing work. That's kind of dragging us down. Like I used in the book, the analogy of the ocean, that in the ocean, you would go to the ocean and to dip into the water, take a cup and, you know, get a cup of ocean water and then take it back home far away from the ocean. That ocean water is still ocean water. No matter how far away from the ocean you take it, it's still ocean water. And in that, it has everything that is in the ocean. Is in a smaller quantity, of course, very minute. It's not as vast and powerful as the ocean, but it is still everything that is in the ocean. It is the essence of ocean in that small container. Like, we are small, minute, infinitesimal containers of divine source energy. And even though we feel like we're disconnected from the ocean, that same ocean water is still vibrating at the same rate of the ocean. once it leaves that container, if you were to take it back to the ocean and pour it back in, the ocean would just absorb it and it wouldn't be any different. And so what happens, I think, to many of us is that we get, you know, we are these containers of divine essence, but we're pouring in all of this low vibration. And so it's diluted us to the point where we don't even know who we are and we can't even connect to each other. And so we've got to now start pouring in some, you know, the way that you can get, like if you had that ocean water in a container and you poured in a whole bunch of crap and dirt, the only way to get it back to ocean water is you got to pour in more ocean water. Mm. So the ocean water is more than the dirt and debris. So the only way for us to solve this, or one way, I won't say the only way, is to pour in more of a higher vibration so that we can lift ourselves to a different understanding, a different way of thinking, a different way of seeing our connections, because we can't do it at this lower frequency that we are all tuned into. But they're different stations for sure. They're different stations. They're different ways of viewing the world, but they're both still many times not at our optimal. We're not operating at our optimal level, because we have so much depression and physical ailments and emotional, where, you know, all of those things that are wearing us down. So it proves that we are not vibrating at our maximum capacity, because if we did, we would have more joy, we would have more love, we would have more peace and all of those things, not in a rose-colored way, but we would really have a different understanding of how all of this is working together and that it really is all good.
So, I mean, the phrase that you use in your book is the importance of finding what you call a VIP, or a vibrationally intelligent perspective, when confronted with racism or other potential traumatic things that happen, incidents in life. I wonder if you could give me an example of how you've applied this perspective to an incident in your life.
Absolutely. I think, you know, I use it all the time. You have to, you're living in America.
Listen to it when I turn the TV on.
Right. And, you know, I can go into my representative, you know, there's a saying that, you know, when two people meet, there's really six people. There's you as you think you are, as the other person thinks that you are, and then who you really are. And so I've kind of termed those three aspects of ourselves as the representative self, our vibrationally intelligent perspective, which is our VIP. And then the last one is the mirror me. It's the part of me that's cleverly disguised as you. It's the part that when I look at you, I'm really seeing a reflection of me, if I'm, you know, really honest about it. You know, all the things that really upset me, you reflect. And so I see it in you. And so I get mad at you because I don't like it in myself. So I certainly am not going to tolerate it in you. Because it really is all about me and my perspective. And then the representative part is the part of us, it's really our ego. It's the part of us that is representative. It is the part of us that is not the truth of who we are. It has a multiplicity of masks that we wear. It's the part of us that you've heard, I don't know if you've heard people that speak of themselves in third person, you know, as if, you know, Niambi doesn't do that. Well, you know, who are you? Like my representative. That's my representative self. That's not my authentic self. And so that vibrationally intelligent perspective is the part of us that is always connected to the ocean, that is connected to our divine source. And it is a choice. I have to choose which one is operating in me. And so examples of that is in my everyday life, and especially with working with girls. When I used to work, do direct service for girls, it was very easy to, you know, they come in with a representative, you know, that they all bad and ain't nothing wrong, ain't, you know, that all is good, and they, you can have this tough exterior because the environment, you know, kind of makes you have to have that. You have to be tough. You don't want to be soft. You know, now girls, especially, you know, calling somebody the B word would have been fighting words. Now it's a term of endearment. Yeah. How you can get really somebody riled up is to say that they weak, you know, or you soft, you know, or, you know, you a punk, you know, kind of thing. And so that's that representative part that, you know, says, well, you know, if I'm a bodyguard, if I'm your representative, I can't be no punk, you know? So, you know, you have to be this, have this tough exterior. And so when you have somebody that's in their representative self, you can't match a representative. If you want to get to peace and some kind of resolution, you can't match a representative with a representative. It's like a football team, you know, when the football, one team sends out their offense, then you're going to send out your defense. And so, and vice versa. So then that gets into this, this battle. And so like, even with my son, I know that if I'm, you know, if I'm upset about something and I come at him as my representative, he's going to show up in his representative. And so then we're going to battle. But if he shows up in his representative, then I have to show up in my VIP. And then if my VIP is there, if I am in a vibrationally intelligent perspective where I am tuned in to the my divine source, then that will help him to remember to tune into his. You know, it's almost like what First Lady, our forever First Lady, Michelle Obama said, you know, when they go low, we go high. Yeah. I think that's what she means in essence, that when you, when somebody shows up with a lower vibration, you can either choose to match that vibration or you can choose, make the choice, the intention to rise above it, because you don't have to attend every argument that you're invited to, every fight. You don't have to show up in that vibration. You have a choice to seek to go to a higher space. And then from there, then that person usually can rise to that occasion. Usually when I'm in any kind of conflict, if somebody's coming at me and their representative, if I show up in my VIP, if I show up where, you know, it's like, put the weapons down. I, you know, I'm not packing. Put your weapons down. Then that, usually that will disarm. But if I show up, you know, you show up, it's a gunfight, you know, where, and we all fall. So somebody has to, you know, I hate the term, somebody has to be the bigger person. Because I think that Black folks have been the bigger person for a long time, but it has to be coupled with being a bigger person, not from a negative perspective, but being a bigger person of rising to the biggerness in us, rising to that divine source. And that's where spirituality comes in. You can't be a bigger, you can be a bigger representative. And then so, you know, we meet fire with fire, you know, which doesn't never make sense. You know, I've never seen a fire, when something is blazing, firemen don't come to the fire with fire hoses full of fire. Right. You know, they come with a different vibration in order to put that fire out. And so that's what, you know, changing our perspective. That's why spirituality is so important in healing this cross-cultural, the illusion of our cross-cultural difference. Because all of this was made up. All of this was, you know, white folks 600 years ago decided that they're, you know, a way to amass wealth and to create that was to create this color system. And so we've generationally been hoodwinked into believing that it's real. And we operate out of that illusion of our disconnection because it has been created ideologies and systems and philosophies and laws and all of those things that we are all subject to if we choose to be, and that way of seeing each other. But we're all mutts and we're all mixed together. But it's understanding that all of this is an illusion, that we are all more connected than we are different. We're not different races even, because if we were different races, we could not procreate together. You can't, you know, we would be creating like a horse and a, what is it, a horse and a donkey?
Dog or whatever, you're right.
A mule, we couldn't, you know, we would be coming up with some hybrid species that would be very different. But we are the same race. And where we get, where it gets all jumbled is that we use race in the same system as racism. Racism is real, but our race is not. And so that's why I use the term cross-cultural because it's different cultures and different philosophies, different mindsets, that if we heal the mindset, then I think all of this would shift. It's not, you know, we're not battling each other. And every time we refer to each other as a different race, we, you know, the vibration of the word race, also the definition says competition. So it's like, how can we get together if we are in a race against each other? You know, if we are separate races, which means that, you know, it's a competition against, and it's part of a indicative of the philosophy and the ideology behind racism is to keep us separate and divided and in how we move in the world. And culturally, there are some differences for sure. And those are the things that we can address and change and be cognizant of them, because when we are in our cultural selves, there's so many gifts that we can share. You know, I love Black culture. Can't nobody do it. And when the others try to do Black culture, it look crazy because it is a cultural nuance. But I'm so glad that there is cultural sharing, because I love Thai food. I love all kinds of music. I love
opera. You like opera?
Yes, I have. There's some fantastic
You're
opera.
Better than me.
I can do just about. I can even do country. I can do, you know, I grew up, my father was a music connoisseur. So we got to hear all kinds of music. And so there's gifts in everything. But, you know, I think, and that those are the gifts of culture that we can, now where it becomes shifty and shady is when you try to appropriate my culture without me. You can't take my culture without also accepting me. You can't take, you know, go in and, you know, it'd be like going to somebody's house and picking through their pantry and deciding, you know, you gonna, you know, take their stuff and then make a meal and then call it your own. You can't, you know, you can't do that without feelings getting hurt and leaving a real salty taste. So it's knowing that, you know, honoring the fact that I can love you, I can love me, and I can love my culture without hating you. And I can be with you without becoming you. And you can be with me without becoming me. That is only, and that's the part that we're having to heal. That's what white people are having to grow in understanding, because they have never had to be held accountable for, you know, you basically they have run the world, ruled the world. And now they're coming to understanding that, you know, just like a game of Monopoly, if you got all the pieces, you got all the expensive property, you got, I don't know if you know Monopoly, but Boardwalk, Park Place, you got all of the expensive property in the game on the Monopoly, and now you wonder why nobody wants to play with you.
All right. Last question here, because I could listen to you for a while, but you know, one of the things that's just wonderful in your book, towards the end of it, you use this kind of a computer analogy when dealing with racism, and you talk about getting rid of malware, which you say that you do on a daily basis. So I wonder if you could give your listeners some idea as to how you reboot. What does Niambi do to reboot, to keep herself grounded in a progressive spiritual flow?
Well, first of all,
it's incredibly confusing times that we live in.
Absolutely. And the first thing that I do, and I have gotten into practice, I don't do it all the time and I don't do it perfectly. I'm a work in progress. But I make sure that on startup, when I wake up in the morning, the first thing that I do is I don't go for my cell phone and start regurgitating or looking at all of the stuff that has happened overnight and yesterday, and then start feeling my mind before I get grounded. And so I like to have my phone because I have an elder mom, and you know, I want to make sure that I'm accessible 24/7. She lives in San Diego, so I want to make sure that if the phone rings at 2 o'clock in the morning, I want to be able to respond. But I don't want it on the side of my bed where I can just mindlessly, you know, pick it up and then 2 or 3 hours have passed because, you know, I get caught in the loop of newsfeed that then sets kind of my mode and my mood for the day. Before I even get out of the bed, I'm stressed out. because of what's happening. So one of the things that I've learned to do is to put my phone in a different outlet, plug it up somewhere that's not right next to my bed. So I have to make the choice and the decision of whether I want to plug in first thing. And just in that opportunity to make that choice, and rather than mindlessly doing it, gives me an opportunity to kind of get grounded, to think about my dreams, to think about what I've just, you know, to check in with my body, to see how I'm feeling, to kind of set my day and my intention for my day without the influence of other things. And so when I start my day like that, I usually have a better day and it's more intentional. I get the things that I want to do done. I can kind of, you know, guide my ship, so to speak, rather than I'm responding to life rather than reacting to it. And so that's a powerful way that I have started. But being intentional, and trying to be mindful of everything that I do and slowing down, you know, I loved even in how we started this interview, and I don't think it was recorded, but just, you know, right before this, I was like rushing all around, but then taking the time to just, you know, to just center in. And I think that that's what's missing. We are running like gerbils all day long. And if we just take time to just kind of slow down and be thoughtful. And so I use a lot of times the analogy of the representative and the VIP throughout my life and throughout the day. And so when I have a visceral negative response to somebody, the first thing I'm thinking is, okay, am I connecting this person to something else? You know, why am I feeling like this? You know, is it this person, or is it because they remind me of somebody else and that I haven't healed? And so, you know, I then get to make the choice of whether I want to do that work, or then I can be present with that person. But everything, you know, everything, we're in this sensory environment. So everything is a reminder or a touchstone to something else. You can hear a song on the radio and it can take you back to seventh grade. You know, you can eat a food and it can engender either a good feeling or a bad memory. So it's being aware that everything is connected. We're connected to everything. There is nothing that sits in silo away from us. Mm-hmm. And it's being aware of all of those intricate connections. I'm being more mindful in my life. I'm being more mindful of everything, every connection or disconnection that I have, and making the choice to either to heal or to be aware that I need healing in that area. Mm-hmm. If I can't do it right there on the spot, then I know that, you know, I need to put a pin in that and revisit that when I have either the time or the resources or the support to do the work that I need to do.
So we've talked about a lot of things. We could talk more. And yes. I'm wondering, for those of you that are listening to this, how they could get in touch with you, how they could get a copy of your books, anything like that that you would like to share.
Well, yeah, the book is in the midst of it's still cooking in the womb. I mean, it's almost ready. It's being edited right now and being swaddled and prettied up for the world. And it should be available very soon.
It'll be on Amazon when it's available.
Yeah, it'll be available on Amazon.com. The title is What Color Is Your Soul? And it will also be available on my website. I have two that I'd like to mention, and that's NiambiJaha.com, NiambiJaha.com. And also crossculturalhealing.com, which is a site that will be that we're developing to do a lot of that personal development work, and also wolfwork.org.
Yeah, I'll put those in the show notes. So I just want to say a little bit of word about the Diversity and Spirituality Network before I thank you finally. Maybe not finally, but
not finally. This is the beginning.
It's the beginning. those of you that want to know more about the network, please visit us on the web, diversityandspirituality.com. And we have every third Saturday of every month, 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, we have what we call online community explorations, where we talk about various things experientially. And you can find more about that by going to our website and looking under events. And also, if you like the podcast, please give us a good rating. If you don't like it, don't give us a rating at all. If you want to support the podcast, please go on patreon.com, look for us, Diversity and Spirituality. For as little as a dollar a month, you can be, in effect, a sponsor of the show. Niambi, it's been an enormous pleasure. And, I just hope we stay connected, and I'm sure we will.
Connected. Yeah, we're connected. I'm clear.
I think you're a chartered member of the Diversity and Spirituality Network.
Yay! Well, I'm going to support, and I'm going to spread the word, and I just know that this will continue to flow because the world needs it. And thank you for the work that you're doing to create a platform to share this message of healing with the world. So, thank you for this opportunity.